Trek Profiles Podcast, Episode 10, recorded August 2018. Trek Profiles Podcast, where each episode we sit down with a Star Trek fan, we learn their story, and we try to figure out why this show means so much to them, to us, and to all of you. I am John, your intrepid host of this whole enterprise, and I welcome you to this, the Trek Profiles Podcast, Episode 10. If you wish to get in touch with us, you can reach us via email at feedback@trekprofiles.com or on Facebook or Twitter at Trek Profiles. If you wish to leave us a voicemail, you can leave a message on our automated voicemail line at 609-512-LLAP. That's 609-512-5527. Spoiler warning! As we record this, we have reached the end of Season 1 of Star Trek Discovery, so all previous Trek content up to and including that point is fair game and may be discussed during this episode. You have been warned, human. As always, my trusty sidekick and co-host is the M5 Multitronic Unit. Greet our listeners, M5.
M5 available. All systems standing by.
M5, what messages do we have?
Messages displayed on console 1.
The Trek Profiles Podcast is a proud member of the Tricorder Transmissions Podcast Network. We have so many great shows, and we're launching another one, if you can believe it. It is Queer Trek, which is going to be focused on the LGBT experience in Star Trek. So episode 1 of that has just dropped as I record this, so feel free to check it out and check out all the other amazing shows at Tricorder. Speaking of the Tricorder Transmissions Network, they have added a brand new feature to the Tricorder Transmissions website, which of course is at www.thetricordertransmissions.com, and it's the ability to leave us a voicemail directly from the website in addition to the automated voicemail line that I spoke about earlier. So if you're on the Tricorder Transmissions website, there is a little tab sticking out on the right-hand side, and you can just tap that or click on that and then record an audio message for any of our shows directly from your computer or mobile device. How cool is that? Just be sure to tell us who you want to leave a message for, because all the shows on the network share the same one. So just go ahead and tell us that, and we'll get it to the right place. So check it out and let us know what you think. If you enjoy this or any of the other shows on the network and you wish to support the network, you may do so through Patreon. Supporting the network gets you early access, unedited episodes, and other goodies. Every little bit that we get goes right back into the network so we can continue to make great content for you. And one of those goodies is Patreon Hangouts. We will be having the next one Saturday, September 22nd at 9 Eastern, 6 Pacific. So if you are a Patreon supporter, you will get an email about that. So please check your emails, and we hope to see you there. Another way you can support this or any of our shows is to visit the show page in iTunes and give us a nice rating and review. And if you aren't an iTunes user, that's okay too. We love you as well. We would appreciate your rating and review in whatever platform you use. Those reviews help other fans find our shows, and we appreciate them so very much. I have some other updates for you. One thing I've started to do is make more complete show notes and posting them on TrekProfiles.com. This started with episode 9, the one with Dr. Aaron, and I'll probably continue to do that. So I will link to all the guests' articles, social media, maybe post a picture or two, and any other goodies that might be relevant or useful. So feel free to check that out at TrekProfiles.com. If by some chance any of you happen to be in or around Las Vegas on October 20th, that's a Saturday, there will be a sci-fi collectibles event sponsored by A&M Collectibles and Comics with food, vendors, and all kinds of stuff at Sin City Pickers. That's 10 West Wyoming Avenue from 10 to 5. And your humble host will actually be there, and I'll be doing some podcasting recording, interviewing fans and such. So feel free to come on down, enjoy the event, get something to eat, and maybe we can talk some Trek. So I hope to see you all there. I want to take a moment to thank Willow Castle Group for providing audio engineering on this edition of the Trek Profiles podcast. There's a link to them on the show notes page at TrekProfiles.com, so go ahead and check them out. All right, Kobayashi Maru time. These are the questions from episode 8 with Justin Ozer. Question one, you're a freshman at Starfleet Academy. Pick your roommate, Wesley Crusher or Tom Paris? Justin said Paris, but the audience vote, amazingly, was 50-50. Who'da thunk it? I did give you the power to unilaterally decide if Paris and Locarno are the same person or not, so if that mattered to you, please feel free to weigh in and hit us up on the Twitter or Facebook. I don't think we've ever had a tie before, by the way, in the Kobayashi Maru, so that's new. How cool. Which Vulcan brings better logic, Tuvok or T'Pol? Justin picked Tuvok, and so did all of you by 73-27%. Most of you seem to feel that T'Pol gets un-Vulcaned in some way, and Tuvok was much more consistent as a character. Question three. Part of Starfleet is diplomacy. You're at a reception for the Ferengi ambassador, and they are serving, what else? Tube grubs. You better eat some, or you'll insult the ambassador. You can have either the mushy ones or the crunchy ones. Take your pick. Justin said crunchy, and crunchy crushed it by 88-12%. Most of that seemed to be that y'all enjoyed the joys of fried foods in general, which is great, but please remember to have your cholesterol checked. We are pro-health here on the Trek Profiles podcast. Question four, Alla Moraine count to four, or hail, hail, fire, and snow? Alla Moraine was the clear winner by 88-12% here, and I am in complete agreement with this outcome. And question five, you entered a darts competition at Quark's, but you lost. There is a consolation prize, however. You get to take your pick. 100 gross of self-sealing stem bolts or 5,000 wrappages of Cardassian yamek sauce. Justin picked the stem bolts, and again, so did all of you by 70-30%. We're still not sure what the heck stem bolts are used for, but I thought more people would have picked the yamek sauce because at least you could eat it, but I guess I'm a little bit more food adventurous than most of you. C'est la vie. That's it for the messages and communiques. Let's move on. M5, let's run the intelligence profile for this week's guest and let's start the show.
M5 acknowledges.
His favorite character is Captain Picard. His favorite ship is the Enterprise refit. His favorite alien is Dukat, that wild and crazy gull. You can find him on Twitter at Barrett's Books and on the Primitive Culture podcast over on Trek FM. He is from London on the Isle of Great Britain Earth in Sector 001. It's Duncan Barrett. Welcome, Duncan, and thanks for being on the podcast.
Hi, John. It's my pleasure. I'm a big fan. It's a daunting but exciting prospect to be joining you.
Oh, well, I'm delighted that you're here. And it's time for question one. Are you a Star Trek fan?
I am, yes. I kind of describe myself as a born-again Star Trek fan. I was a massive fan in the 90s, like a lot of people, I guess, when I was a teenager. And then I think my fandom kind of waned slightly. I became a kind of lapsed fan. I'd attend church maybe twice a year, two or three times a year, you know, sort of Christmas and Easter. I'd chuck on a few episodes. But other than that, I was a bit of a lapsed fan. And then it was only really in 2015 my son was born. For some reason, that kind of triggered my fandom. It got me back into Star Trek, partly because I was responsible for a lot of night feeds and a lot of for a while he would only sleep literally through the night if he was in a sling on someone's chest, so I used to have to sit up with the headphones on watching something on TV, and I got massively back into Next Gen at that time. My fandom's kind of regrown out of that process, I think.
So you originally started with Next Gen and then you got back into it through Next Gen, or were there other series?
Yeah, I did really. I mean, I'd seen maybe one or two episodes of the original series. I'd seen a little bit of The Undiscovered Country. I think I saw the second half of it on TV, but I really wasn't that into Star Trek at all. I was kind of aware that it existed. This was probably when I was about, I don't know, 10 or 11, something like that. And then I got into Next Gen. I was visiting my cousins over in Dublin and they had satellite TV, which we didn't have in my house at home, and that time they were showing Next Gen. It'd probably be like maybe season, I don't know, I guess season 5 or 6, sort of fairly late Next Gen then. And they were quite into it. And so I watched a few episodes when I was over, you know, I was over there for like a week's holiday or something, and got completely hooked to the point that I started getting them to post me VHS tapes over in the mail of the latest episodes so that I could watch them. Because the BBC was showing Star Trek. They were showing Next Gen at that time, I think, but they were a bit behind and it was all quite complicated working out who was showing what when. But I really got kind of properly hooked, I suppose. It must have been like a few months after that when I was off school for a period of time. I was off school for several months with glandular fever, or mono, I think you call it. So, you know, you're just kind of exhausted, you're wiped out, you're basically lying in bed all day, not doing very much. And I discovered that our local Blockbuster video store had the whole of Next Gen up to that point, whenever it was, you know, like I say, sort of going up to fairly late in the series run, I think. And I'd basically send my mum off every day to go and, you know, get me the next couple of tapes. And they had, I think these tapes they had four episodes per take. So she'd bring me one and I'd watch that day, and then she'd go back the next day and swap it for the next one. And I kind of worked my way through to the point where by the time I went back to school, you know, by the time I recovered, I was a pretty diehard Star Trek fan.
Oh, fantastic. So that was Next Gen. And then did you find your way to the other series?
I did, absolutely. I watched DS9 and Voyager, I watched in first run. It's funny, I mean, I don't know if you've spoken to anyone else over on this side of the pond, because obviously the timing of when we got different Star Trek episodes and, you know, what was shown when and who got it in different places. I mean, I know it probably varied all over the States, depending on your, you know, your local network or whatever. But over here, it was quite different as well. I mean, to begin with, for a start, there was often a significant time delay. But there was also, I think the episodes were kind of jumbled up, so they weren't necessarily shown, not that they were shown out of order, though that did happen. But also that the delays wouldn't necessarily be in sync. So for a lot of the time, I was actually, again, watching DS9 and Voyager because, you know, as I say, we didn't have the satellite TV. And I think once I was quite into Star Trek, I wanted to see stuff as soon as it was available. I didn't want to wait 2 years or whatever it was going to be for the BBC to get it. And I actually started buying the like official VHS tapes, which looking back on it, I mean, people complain about, you know, paying for CBS All Access or whatever. Not that we have to do this here in the UK, I have to say. But, you know, people complain about the cost of watching Star Trek. I mean, in those days, for me, it must have been ruinously expensive, you know, buying these tapes every month that they'd come out. But so basically, certainly for the latter years of DS9 and Voyager, it would be a case of whenever the next tapes come out, you'd go and you get two DS9 episodes and two Voyager episodes. So you would essentially get a little kind of four episode binge watch, and then you'd have to wait another fortnight, I think it would be, until the next tape came out. So really a lot of my kind of Star Trek viewing experience in first run was all about the tapes. It wasn't really, I mean, I don't know if I've ever seen a Star Trek episode like with adverts on TV, if you know what I mean, because we don't tend to have them over here in the UK, or certainly when the BBC showed things, they didn't have them. So I guess it's quite a different experience in a way from seeing something week after week. And, you know, everyone talks about waiting for that huge break over Best of Both Worlds and what it was like kind of seeing it in first run. I mean, I kind of missed that, so I could go and get the next tape the next day or send my mum out to get it or whatever. But I suppose in a way, I did have a slightly more fragmented Star Trek viewing in some ways because of basically viewing it through these kind of physical media rather than viewing it through broadcast.
I've talked on the podcast previously that sometimes when I'm binging, quote unquote, some of Star Trek, it has a different effect on me. The same episodes, when I see them back to back, sometimes like the continuity between them, I notice things, or I find two episodes that are wildly different juxtaposed next to each other doesn't have a salutary effect. Did you have that a similar experience or no?
Well, I don't remember finding that sort of in first run, as it were, or on my own first kind of exposure. Although I suppose what happens when you get the episodes like that is you've got a, whatever it is, a 2 week period or whatever with those four episodes, and you probably rewatch out of the four, you might, I think I would kind of pick my favorite one. I'd probably watch that over and over and over again. And some of the other ones, if I wasn't that keen on it, I might just kind of give it a miss. I did notice 50th anniversary over at the Trek FM network. We had a podcast project called From There to Here. And this was before I was actually podcasting over there. I was just listening as a fan of the network, basically. But it was basically a complete works rewatch going in Stardate order. So they started with Enterprise and then they went all the way through to Voyager. And I was following along with that and doing my own rewatch and trying my best to kind of cram the whole 700 and whatever it is, 20 something episodes into a year, which is, I don't know if you've ever tried doing that. It's pretty tough because it means watching an average of like two episodes a day. I did manage to do it by the end of the year, mainly by having a few like day long binges where you can kind of catch up a bit. But and the way they were doing it, because they were doing it not quite in release date order, but in star date order, but they're kind of similar once you get to, say, the overlapping series, is it would be, you know, a DS9 episode, a Voyager episode, it might be like two Voyager episodes and then another DS9 or whatever. But I found when I was doing the rewatch, I started off trying to do that, but I found it really hard jumping back and forth constantly between those two series, oddly, even though that's, of course, what I'd been doing originally and what, you know, most people were doing, I guess, in first run. I found it much easier to sort of binge a season of one show and then go and do a season of the other one and kind of do it that way, or at least a kind of stretch of episodes, maybe like six or seven episodes, just because I think particularly with something like Deep Space Nine, obviously because it's more serialized, you do get sort of more sucked into it. I found I was kind of resistant to switching over to the other show and going back and forth constantly. I really wanted to kind of immerse myself in one or the other for a bit more of a stretch of time, and then maybe when I wanted a bit of a break, I wanted something a bit different, I'd go over and do a few episodes of the other one.
So that was during the Trek FM rewatch project. But when you're on your own, do you jump around still, or do you still discipline yourself in your rewatch and sort of watch whole series and or whole seasons?
I very rarely rewatch whole seasons in one stretch. I mean, partly because a lot of the Star Trek that I watch these days, because I do have my own podcast now, and my podcast, it looks at Star Trek in terms of it'd be a particular sort of theme or topic that we're looking at each week. So my podcast, Primitive Culture, it's basically about the kind of inspirations on Star Trek from the real world, whether that's real world history or literature or film or whatever. And so typically, you know, if we're doing an episode on, I don't know, hang on, let me try and think of a good example that makes this point. What have we done episodes on recently?
Well, while you're thinking about that, I'll tell you, I have a similar experience in that I tend to watch the whole thing straight through. So I started with Mission Log, actually, when they launched their podcast. And I was watching every single episode as they watched it. So I was watching an episode a week, starting from the beginning, and I kept right up with it. Right up until when I started doing this show, and then I just ran way ahead. So now I'm at Deep Space Nine season 6 as we record this, in the middle of season 6. Mm-hmm. And they're just getting to the end of season 1 and just starting season 2, and I'm going to continue on full speed ahead. But I've had to watch episodes in preparation for the podcast that I know I have not seen before, specifically Voyager episodes. And it seems I'm pretty sure I watched all of Enterprise. In fact, I would bet on it. Because I know where I was in life, and I know what I had going on at the time it was on the air, and I know I watched all the episodes, but I will tell you that I have watched some episodes in prep for this podcast thinking, I have no recollection of this whatsoever. Like, there's nothing going, nothing is happening. And I sort of resent it a little. I think, it's out of order now. Very, very much first world problems.
I quite enjoyed that on my, like, Complete Works rewatch. In a way, I found that the episodes that I'd gone back to over the years and that I knew I loved, you know, and the kind of fan favourites, The Inner Light or, you know, The Best of Both Worlds or whatever, these kind of big episodes, I know, Far Beyond the Stars, whatever it's going to be, I knew what to expect. I knew those episodes quite well. And it's not to say I didn't enjoy watching them, because they're always, you know, a pleasure to watch. But what I really enjoyed about that whole process was finding the episodes that I'd completely forgotten about and that, you know, I probably hadn't rewatched, that I'd probably seen once before and never gone back to. And yeah, some of them, there was a reason I hadn't gone back to them. Others, there was something in there, you know, even if the whole episode wasn't brilliant, there was something in there that caught my attention or that really made it worthwhile. Sometimes there's a B story that's fantastic in an otherwise unremarkable episode, and therefore that one kind of gets, you know, filtered out of the kind of, out of the deck in a way when you're kind of going back to things. So I guess there is a definite benefit to, you know, doing the whole thing, doing the whole rewatch. But what I was going to say earlier, shall I just finish what I was going to say about my show? I thought of an example now. So for me, it tends to be more because when I'm watching episodes for my own podcast, Primitive Culture, which keeps me quite busy. So it's generally the reason I'm watching specific Star Trek at the moment. There'll be a particular topic. So for example, recently we did an episode on epidemics and disease. So we'll decide that's the topic. We'll draw up a list of, you know, 6 or 7 or 8 episodes, probably spanning. They might be spanning every single iteration of Star Trek, or certainly spanning like 2 or 3 of them. And then we'll go and look at those episodes. So that's what I'll be watching that week. And then the next week it'll be, you know, something completely different. It'll be, I don't know, we did an episode on fatherhood, or we did an episode on, you know, all sorts of different topics that direct me towards specific episodes. So my rewatching these days is much more kind of scattershot in a way, but I quite like that. I think it keeps things interesting. It helps me to kind of maintain a sense of Star Trek as a whole. I suppose the fact that I'm jumping around here and there stops me from getting too sort of bogged down in, you know, in a long ongoing rewatch project. I did recently rewatch the whole of the X-Files, in first run I'd kind of given up about season 6, I think, so almost half of it was kind of pretty much new to me, and that was an interesting experience. I really enjoyed it, and I really enjoyed going back to the early episodes that I'd seen of that in first run, but I hadn't seen for many years. But it was a bit of a slog, you know, getting through, you know, years after years after years after years of the same program. It definitely appeals to me more, I think, now. You know, the way that I watch Star Trek is a little bit more in and out and kind of a bit of a shallower dive somehow. That sort of appeals to me now.
Perfect, perfect. Are you a collector at all?
Not really, not massively. I mean, I've got all the episodes on DVD or Blu-ray where that's the case, obviously. I've got about 5 or 6 little Eagle Moss ships that I acquired at various times. I guess I've got a bunch of Star Trek books, but no, I'm not sort of hugely into collecting. For me, I think it's all about the episodes and the films. It's kind of about the actual, you know, on-screen product in a way. That's what Star Trek is to me in terms of, you know, what I might kind of have of it.
You ever been to a convention?
Only once, actually. I went in the 90s. I went to a convention, but it was a pretty big one. It was in the Royal Albert Hall in London, which I don't know if you've ever been there, but if not, it's a magnificent, beautiful old sort of concert venue, huge venue with a great big domed ceiling. So it was quite a grand environment for a convention, you know, certainly compared to, say, I don't know, a kind of convention center or a hotel or something. It's a very sort of grand performance venue. I remember George Takei talked about he'd been climbing up on the roof and peering down through the dome at the sort of thousands of people seated inside. But that was kind of a great experience. I really enjoyed that. And the thing I remember about that is it must have been in, I guess, 94, maybe 94, early 95, because Voyager had yet to debut. No one had seen Voyager, but they had a couple of the actors from Voyager there, I guess, kind of sort of getting them used to the whole sort of convention experience. And Ethan Phillips was there, and he came on stage and talked for a while. And no one had seen Neelix. No one knew anything about Voyager. But this guy, you know, just came on stage and was chatting about what it was like working on the new show. And he seemed very engaging, and he seemed like a really nice guy. And I think it really affected my viewing of Voyager going into it, because I know a lot of people really hate Neelix. He's like one of their least favourite characters. I've always had a kind of soft spot for him, and I'm sure that that is in part because before I met Neelix, I encountered Ethan Phillips at this convention, and he just seemed like a very kind of likeable guy, and that made me feel positively disposed to him. But I've never been back up till now. I'm hoping to go to the convention in Birmingham later this year, so there'll be a gap of, you know, quite a few years in between, but it'll be good to go back and you know, see how things have changed.
Oh, that'll be delightful. It's funny you talk about seeing Ethan Phillips before Voyager went on the air, because I had a similar experience with Discovery. I was very familiar with Mary Wiseman because she had been a guest on several episodes of a comedy show over here called Baskets. I don't know if you're familiar with it. The comedic actor, Zach Galifianakis. So he plays an angry and bitter guy who tried to get into clowning and failed. And Mary Wiseman played basically a sort of defective street clown called Trinity. And she was delightfully insane in the role. And I just thought she's fantastic, but a very different kind of character than what she plays on the show. But I just kept thinking, where is she? I don't know, because obviously we didn't know anything about Tilly except that she was going to be a cadet. And I just kept thinking, I don't know where this is going to go. I mean, she was great, but it was just, it caused a little bit of trepidation because she was, the character she had played was very much unlike anything you had ever seen in any kind of Star Trek. So it was quite interesting for me to see her take on that role. And she did great with it, and I was really happy. So you made the decision, after being involved in Star Trek fandom for a few years, to become a podcaster. Tell me, why did you decide to become a podcaster?
I was roped into it by my former co-host, Tony Black, who actually was the one who inspired me to go back and watch The X-Files as well. He runs a podcast network called The X-Cast, where they talk about The X-Files every week. And he'd been listening to Trek FM. I had guested at that point on a couple of Trek FM shows. I ended up guesting very last minute at the very end of the From There to Here rewatch, because someone pulled out and I'd been kind of engaging with the hosts sort of as a fan, and you know, and said, oh, if you ever, you know, need a spare person, let me know. And someone dropped out, so I ended up doing a few episodes of that. And then I had guested on one or two episodes of Metatreks, which is our sort of Star Trek and philosophy podcast, talking about, in particular, Star Trek and World War II history, which is kind of my field professionally. I work as a writer, and I write sort of popular history books generally around that era. And so Tony had listened into that episode, and he'd been thinking of trying to pitch a sort of Star Trek and history podcast idea. And he basically just sent me an email and said, you know, what do you think? Do you want to come on board and do the show with me? And I said yes, slightly trepidatiously, and then found out I absolutely loved it. I mean, for me, it's a great way not just to have an excuse to go and watch loads of Star Trek, which is nice, but it's also a great way for me to learn about periods of history or books or films or, you know, whatever they are that I've not encountered before. And so now that Tony left some months ago, I now have a new co-host, Clara, who I do the show with. But really, I'm just incredibly grateful to him for sort of twisting my arm and getting me to do this show, because it's a great opportunity for me to, you know, spend a week or two kind of reading up on a subject that is slightly outside my general comfort zone, get enough information, get enough kind of knowledge on that in order to talk about it for a couple of hours in relation to Star Trek. And then, you know, it's on to the next thing. So one week it might be, I don't know, the Nuremberg trials. The next week it might be Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. I really enjoy having that sort of being able to jump from one topic to another and being able to, you know, approach things in a kind of a slightly briefer way than, you know, when I'm researching a book, it might be several years of my life working on one topic and it's all very kind of detailed and, you know, trying to find out everything there is to know about that particular thing. And you become a real expert on something and then you have to go on and do the same thing for the next thing over the next few years. So it's just nice for me to be able to kind of dip in and out a little bit more. So that's how I got into hosting my show, and I absolutely love it. I mean, I don't know about you. I really enjoy the podcasting as much for the research, really, as for the actual show that we put out.
Oh, it's fantastic. And I was surprised to hear you say that you guested on Metatrex, because I've actually been working my way through Metatrex.
Oh, well, you'll get to me in the end.
Okay, fantastic. No, I went back to the beginning. They had a really interesting episode, which I was, how do I phrase this? They had an episode I was very excited to see, download, and listen to, and they didn't address the topic what I thought they were going to address. They addressed a different topic with great skill, and it was wonderful. It was their episode on the Ship of Theseus. I read a lot of philosophy when I was in college, so I'm very familiar with the Greeks, very familiar with all of that. And when they were actually talking about the ship, you know, the actual Enterprise, right? Is it the same Enterprise, the refit? Is it the same Enterprise that we saw in the 60s show, right? And what does it mean, right? When you change out so many pieces, is it the same ship? I have this idea that Star Trek as a franchise, as the Ship of Theseus, right? You have the original show, and then they replace a showrunner. Then someone else comes in. They take this part off. They bolt on this other thing. Now there's this new concept they add to it. Then you have the animated series, which takes things in like a very weird direction. Then you have Next Gen, where they have a completely different set of showrunners at some point, and they sort of put their own spin on things. And is there any relation to the Star Trek of today to the Star Trek of the 60s, right? And like, what does that spectrum look like? Like that's the discussion that I thought in my head they were going to have. There's nothing wrong with the episode they did. It was fantastic, but it was much more about the actual ship. So that's a discussion I hope they have someday, because I'll eagerly be tuning into that.
Yeah, no, I see what you mean. Absolutely. And I think one of the things that I love about Star Trek is just how versatile a kind of format it is. You know, the fact that even generically it can vary so much. I mean, we say, yeah, it's science fiction, but at the same time, one week it might be a courtroom drama. One week it might be a romantic comedy. You know, it can kind of play with genre to such a great extent. And that's one of the things that I really love Discovery. I enjoy Discovery a lot. One of my anxieties about Star Trek becoming more serialized and having these kind of shorter seasons, and I understand all the kind of reasons for it and the kind of that's what TV is these days, and also there are kind of financial considerations and so on. But my hesitation about Star Trek becoming that kind of TV product is that maybe you might lose a little bit of the kind of experimentation, a little bit of the kind of wackiness in a way that you get when you have to produce whatever it is, 24 or 26 episodes a year. And, you know, some of my favorite episodes are the ones where they really went with something, you know, kind of a bit strange. I mean, I mentioned Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. You know, the episode One Small Ship from Deep Space Nine is a completely mad idea, but at the same time, you know, they pulled it off. It worked really well. Recently, I did an episode looking at In the Cards, another DS9 episode that, you know, seems very kind of silly in a way on the face of it, that doesn't seem like a kind of important, significant story in the way that we think Star Trek is telling these great morality stories and doing this kind of important work and so on. But at the same time, if you lose those kind of slightly offbeat concepts, I don't know, I sort of worry that they are part of what makes Star Trek so special. And, you know, I'm hoping we'll see more of that going forward. I guess we got it with Magic to Make the Sanest Men Go Mad. Magic to Make the Sanest Man.
Yeah, now, we know what you meant.
I guess we got it with Magic to Make the Sanest Man Go Mad. In Discovery, they did sort of manage to put in there an almost a standalone episode and a kind of, quite a kind of crazy, eccentric, you know, quite entertaining one that pretty much worked outside of the broader serialized narrative. But I hope that they kind of do more of that going forward and with whatever other Star Trek series we have coming down the pipeline as well.
Well, perhaps, and this is, of course, the most idle of speculation, but perhaps with these little mini-sodes that they're releasing, I believe, in fourth quarter, they're giving themselves the space to do that. We don't know what they're going to be. We don't know what sort of tone they're going to have. But, you know, it'll certainly give them a little bit more of a canvas to paint on.
That's true. Absolutely. They're going to be pretty short, aren't they? They're like 15 minutes each or something. So,
yeah.
But I don't know. We'll see. I mean, the animated series, they were only 22 minutes or something, and they managed to get through quite a lot of plot in that time. So, yeah, it'll be interesting to see. I mean, obviously, you know, the format has always changed to some extent. I mean, the length of the episodes, you know, from the original series through to Enterprise, there's quite a number of minutes getting, you know, chopped with each successive series there. And that kind of affects the pacing and the way that the stories are told and so on. But I just hope that somewhere in the kind of raft of new Star Trek for TV that we get, they kind of make space for some of those slightly sort of unexpected gems, as well as focusing on the kind of, you know, the big story and the big narrative, which I kind of feel is where the emphasis is these days with the way that people tend to watch TV.
Well, since we've been talking about it, let's jump in and actually talk about some episodes in detail. As always, I had the M5 do some gentle internet sleuthing and some perhaps not so gentle, and has prepared a list of episodes that we should talk about. I'm looking at this list, and one of the episodes I think we should talk about, because I think it ties into something that you were just bringing up, is an Enterprise episode, Observer Effect. And the reason I want to talk about it is because in my prep for the show, I discovered that this was one of these episodes where they were just out of budget. And they had to do a bottle show. And so their whole point was, you know, okay, we need to make an episode that doesn't have any guest stars and doesn't have a lot of special effects and doesn't have a lot of whole new sets. And they had this big constraint and they produced this whole episode about the Organians actually inhabiting the bodies of some of our heroes. And this infection is running wild on the ship. So tell me why this episode is meaningful and or interesting to you.
Yeah, I absolutely love this episode. It's, do you know what? Until you said that, right? I mean, it makes so much sense, you saying that it's a bottle episode, there's no guest stars, etc. I don't know why that had never crossed my mind watching this episode. I think because it is so well made and it is so gripping, it doesn't feel like a kind of cheap, disposable episode to me. It feels like everyone really kind of firing on all cylinders. I'm not the biggest fan of Enterprise, generally speaking. I mean, Enterprise was the series that slightly killed my Star Trek fandom the first time round, if you know what I mean. I think it was a combination of I know. and I've grown to love it. You know, it has a place in my heart now, but it is probably definitely towards the bottom of my kind of feelings about the various Star Trek series for various reasons. But I do think Observer Effect is a fantastic episode. I think partly it's genuinely scary, which is, you know, it's tricky for, you know, Star Trek doesn't always manage that, especially with diseases and things like that. You know, we don't, often we kind of get the feeling like, yeah, well, everyone's going to be cured. Of course, they're not going to die. We'll all kind of be okay. You know, we have these sort of comforting ideas that we know what kind of this sort of TV show is likely to do. And of course, that is what happens at the end of it. But in the meantime, I think they really push the kind of the fear and the anxiety and the horror buttons pretty hard. And it is quite a kind of gritty, nasty episode in some ways, in that the disease seems genuinely scary. It takes hold of them very quickly. They really look pretty ill. I mean, the makeup on that episode does a great job, I think, of making the characters. They don't just look sort of TV ill, you know, where sometimes on TV and on Star Trek as well, characters on TV, they sort of, the actors look ill, but they also look like sort of, you know, healthy young actors at the same time. Do you know what I mean? Because I don't want to make them look too...
Yeah, well, sometimes it's the actor's vanity in some cases, I suspect.
Exactly, yeah. Well, I feel like in that one, they look genuinely pretty rough. They seem like people who are kind of at death's door. And I think it combines this kind of quite gripping, quite pacey sort of medical drama with then the way they bring in the Organians and the way they kind... And the fact that we only find out at the very end of the episode that that's who they are, I think is a great touch, because for me, one of the things I didn't like about Enterprise is the kind of prequeliness of it, and the way that certainly in a lot of early episodes there was something a little bit cheap about the way that it handled being a prequel series. Partly the way they kept shoving things in, like the Ferengi, who had kind of no reason to be there. Partly, you know, you had lines like Captain Archer had that line about, you know, one day someone's going to come up with a directive, and, you know, this kind of real sort of cheesy approach to being a prequel, I think, slightly stifled the show. Whereas I feel like by this point, you know, in season four, partly because it had gone its own way a little bit in season three, it had managed to kind of carve out a new shape for itself. And in season four, of course, as well, they did a lot of much more interesting work, and they kind of managed to make the prequel side of the show work for them rather than work against them, I think. Rather than it being a kind of constraint that they were having to deal with in their storytelling, they actually started getting into slightly deeper issues. So you had the whole, you know, Vulcan arc, or you had the whole Babel arc and so on. And those were kind of functioning as a prequel, but in a kind of meaningful way. And then I think in Observer Effect, they managed to, you know, just sort of just tie into the original series, but in quite a small, in quite a kind of subtle way, and off the back of an episode that totally worked on its own terms. You know, you don't need to know anything about the original series or about the Organians for that episode to work. It is a very self-contained, very successful story. And for me, Enterprise, I mean, I'm one of those people who, my favourite season of Enterprise is the third season. I know that's not necessarily a popular view, but I kind of feel that show works best when the stakes are high, when it gets a bit dark, when it gets a bit gritty, partly because I think for me, one of the problems with Enterprise was I don't think it had the characters that some of the previous series had. I mean, you know, there are characters in there that I love. Dr. Phlox I really like. T'Pol I like. Trip I have quite a lot of time for. But a lot of the characters in Enterprise seem a little bit flat, I think, compared to some previous iterations of Star Trek. And I think for me, that means that it really is a show. A show like DS9 can almost sell you the flimsiest of premises on the strength of its character interactions and its character comedy and its character drama and so on. Enterprise, I think, really needed kind of strong narrative and strong plot to kind of keep you there and to kind of keep you gripped. And I think they kind of found that more in the third season, for me anyway, you know, with that ongoing Zindi arc, they kind of really upped the stakes and it kind of made it feel like this was a show that where, you know, it sort of meant something somehow and these people were going through something significant in a way that, you know, those first two seasons, I mean, I can go back and rewatch them now and I enjoy them more than I did certainly in first run. To be honest, I only watched about six episodes and then gave up on the show altogether, I think. But you know, for me, it's the kind of latter half of Enterprise where it starts to work more as a show because I think it gets a little bit more of a bite. And Observer Effect is definitely an episode with bite and that's one reason that I love it.
So, Duncan, the M5 has flagged an episode for me to ask you about, but it has also told me that I should ask about this episode in the context of something going on in the wider world. So I'm not sure what this means, so I'm just going to throw it out and you tell me where we should go with it. What does Darmok have to do with the Brexit referendum?
Well, there's a big question. Yeah. I mean, for me personally, it has a lot to do with the Brexit referendum, and that's partly a matter of timing, but I think kind of thematically it does as well. Basically, I mean, Darmok is an episode, I always like this episode, I always thought it was a great episode. You know, I think Patrick Stewart gives a great performance, I think it's a really interesting story. It's a Joe Manosky story, and I think it's one of his kind of best, probably is his best, slightly off the wall, slightly wacky concept. You know, the whole idea of the Temarian language, I think, is a brilliant piece of science fiction writing because it's so strange and so alien and such a kind of, you know, it's a real idea that as you're watching it, you kind of have to grapple with. But for me personally, when I watched this episode during my kind of complete works rewatch, as I mentioned, it happened that it fell the morning after the Brexit referendum here in the UK. And so I woke up this morning and it was, you know, I saw the news that the UK had voted to leave the EU, which was a bit of a shock decision. No one was really, I think, expecting that it was going to go that way, although it was fairly close. People were thinking, I mean, certainly when I went to bed the night before, I think people were still thinking that it was going to be a Remain vote. And I was very disappointed about that myself. I thought it was a terrible decision, had various feelings about that whole campaign. But I just found watching, and bear in mind, I was a bit sleep deprived because I've been up late watching the kind of, you know, political coverage and so on. Probably hadn't got that much sleep and then got up early in the morning and was sticking Darmok on over breakfast. But it really hit me. I mean, I was sitting there in tears watching this episode. And what it was that struck me about it so much is that this is an episode about two people who are so committed to mutual understanding. You know, both Picard and Dathon, the Temarian captain, are putting everything they have into trying to form a kind of meaningful bond between them, to trying to understand each other, to the extent that the Temarian captain is willing to sacrifice his life, and in fact does lose his life, on this huge gamble just to try and preserve a kind of communication between these two people. And it just really struck me that one of the things that I think Star Trek means to so many people, and certainly that it meant to me, is it is a kind of, in a sense, you know, people talk of it as a kind of blueprint for the future or whatever. It's not just a blueprint for the kind of society that we might want to build, but it's also a kind of model for the kind of behaviour that we want to see exemplified, for the standards that we want to live up to. And the reason that, you know, you mentioned earlier, Captain Picard is probably my favourite character in Star Trek, is I think he's just such an inspiring character. I mean, he is the embodiment of Roddenberry's kind of utopian idea of the future and the kind of the evolved sensibility that he talks about in First Contact. You know, that kind of the person who always does the right thing, who's very kind of measured, who's very reasonable, who's really someone to look up to. Certainly that's how I felt watching Star Trek when I was younger. And I think for me personally as well, he meant something to me because I didn't have really any male role models in my life, particularly at that time. So I think I always sort of looked up to Picard in a way, as many, you know, boys and young men probably did. And I suppose it just struck me seeing the contrast between these two men on screen who were really, you know, willing to risk their lives, in one case to sacrifice his life, to try and form a bond between their two, you know, nations in effect. And then seeing what was playing out on the TV news at the same time, where, you know, our nation was withdrawing from this kind of collective group of nations, backing away was kind of, you know, pulling up the drawbridge in a sense. And also the fact that it had followed this period of, you know, one of the, well, probably the ugliest political campaign that I've ever witnessed in my lifetime. You know, we had literally people employing, quite literally, Nazi propaganda was being used, lies just spread all over the place. You know, we had a politician murdered for her political beliefs, for trying to, you know, say what she thought was right. I mean, it was the most unpleasant side of politics. And of course, and the whole referendum, of course, had only been called by a prime minister, David Cameron, who did it to try and get himself, you know, one more year in office. Basically, it was purely for personal benefit that referendum was called, and he thought he could manage it. And he made a massive miscalculation and gambled the future of the entire country, potentially, out of his own self-interest. And it just struck me there was such a huge disparity between what Star Trek had kind of taught me and taught a whole generation of Star Trek fans, I suppose, to think of as, you know, are these kind of noble leaders, you know, someone like Picard, someone like the Tamaran captain, these kind of icons of enlightened, selfless, compassionate leadership, where the emphasis is on diplomacy and understanding and trying to, you know, get to know the stranger, the person that has a different experience from you. And yet in the real world, it felt like everything was going absolutely in another direction. There couldn't have been more contrast between our leaders and the kind of leaders of the Star Trek world. And it just, I don't know, it really kind of profoundly hit me there. It was a very kind of disillusioning experience, as it would have been anyway, even if I hadn't happened to throw that episode on, I suppose. But it really brought home what an absolute failure our own political classes had been in terms of representing anything other than naked self-interest, really, and how far that is from the kind of Star Trek ideal, which is all about, you know, self-sacrifice and the greater good, the needs of the many, and kind of compassion and understanding for those who are different from you.
One of the podcasts that I listen to totally outside the realm of Star Trek is I listen to the public lecture series from the London School of Economics. And this is going to be a gross generalization. I don't know if you ever listen to those podcasts, but this is going to be a horrible generalization, and I beg everyone's forgiveness for making it, but it's there is a kernel of truth in this. One third of it is complete academic nonsense that has no practical application in the outside world besides the academy talking to itself. One third of it is incredibly powerful and moving and inspiring ideas that change the way I think about the world. And the other third of it, I call Brexit hand-wringing, where, you know, what are we going to do now? What does this mean? You know, what should we have done? What could we have done? What, you know, and all that. And I remember listening to one of the episodes, and I'm going to bring this back to Star Trek here in just a second. I remembered listening to one of the episodes where they had a panel on of professors, and one of the professors brought up a point, and I want to bring this to you and have you respond to it, where she said, well, you have to remember that all of us sitting here in this room and all of us here at the London School of Economics, we're the people who are really benefiting from this. And so when people like us and people that are in our class, when we go on TV and we say things like the four freedoms of the EU are wonderful things, to us it is. But to that person who's a plumber in the Midlands, he's hearing the four freedoms. One of those is free movement of people. They're coming for my job. That is a positive message that I'm putting out. It's a negative message mm-hmm. that he's hearing. And I was thinking about that as you were talking in the terms of the campaign, that it has a lot to do with the language, with the Temerian language. That, you know, even the example that I think Troy gives in the episode of Juliet on her balcony, you could say it's an image of love. You could mm-hmm. also say it's an image of someone who's about to die, who's doomed. And depending on who you are and how you interpret it, you could be seeing the same scene and interpreting it in very different ways. And it seemed to me that in the Brexit campaign in particular, just as someone who has paid some little bit of attention to it across the pond here, it seemed to me that there was a lot of those crossed messages where people were saying one thing with the best of intentions, and it was being interpreted negatively by the people who were watching it. And there was a lot of negative stuff too, and a lot of the other things we're talking about as well. But I'm curious to hear what you have to say about it.
I mean, that may be true, but I think also from a sort of historical perspective, looking at this campaign in terms of, you know, certainly politics in my lifetime, I think it also represented a watershed. And, you know, you've had the same thing in the United States in a way with Trump and this whole kind of post-truth landscape, insofar as so much of the campaign was just based on, you know, lying, essentially. I mean, they had this bus famously that was saying, you know, if we leave the EU, we'll have £350 million to send to the NHS. A complete lie, to the extent that, you know, the morning after the referendum, basically all the people who'd been backing this claim were saying, oh, well, you know, of course, we weren't really promising that. No, that probably won't be true. You know, that was just a possibility. That was just an idea. And, you know, as I mentioned, literally the kind of, I mean, yes, the plumber might be worried about his job, but you had the Leave campaign using these old Nazi propaganda posters to try and stir up hatred of immigrants and migrants and so on. And, you know, misdirecting people's fears for their own political ends. So I suppose, yes, I hear what you're saying, that maybe there's an issue that the people who are speaking are not making the case well enough. And certainly that's, I'm not disputing that, you know, the other side in that campaign didn't necessarily do a good enough job in making the case to remain. But at the same time, for me, what that campaign represented is more a shift in the kind of dirty tricks and the kind of, you know, really bringing politics kind of down into the mud, rather than politics being something where there are certain kinds of rules and there are kind of limits on what you can do and say. And there are, you know, even to do with, say, things like election spending, you know, trying to stick to the play by the rules, essentially, in a campaign like that, and kind of, you know, win or lose it based on reasoned arguments rather than essentially kind of dirty tricks. I mean, it's interesting. I was thinking, obviously, we don't know what this new Picard series is going to be that Patrick Stewart has signed on for, but he mentioned how changes in the political world, in the real world, had made him think that maybe it was time to go back to Picard. And I think everyone that I've heard talking about this has assumed that he's talking about Trump, and it's something about the age of Trump that he wants to kind of reflect on in this series. I wouldn't assume that that's the case at all. I mean, Patrick Stewart was quite a vocal opponent of Brexit. You know, he was out campaigning, I think, for the UK to remain. Obviously, that is not the way the vote went in the end. But, you know, he also will have witnessed that whole campaign and the kind of ugliness of it and the direction that our country has taken in the last 2 years. And I wonder whether that is something that, you know, he said he thinks this is an age that kind of needs Jean-Luc Picard again. And maybe that's true. Maybe, you know, the person who is a diplomat who will kind of try to make a bridge of understanding, will try to kind of seek some kind of commonality, some kind of understanding with those who are different from themselves, rather than just saying, well, yeah, you know, that they're after my job. This is a stranger. I don't want anything to do with them. I don't trust this person. They're probably a criminal. They're probably going to rape my wife. You know, whatever it is, all this kind of fear and anxiety and hostility and so on. I suppose for me also, as someone who writes about the Second World War, you know, and as my job is basically interviewing people who lived through the Second World War and lived through that kind of post-war period and all the sort of achievements of that post-war period. You know, in Britain, we had the achievements of the welfare state, of the founding of the National Health Service, all these kind of great kind of social projects. We also, on an international level, had the kind of coming together of different countries, you know, often countries that had been enemies not that long before, to work for a common good. And to me, that is very much, you know, part of the message of Star Trek. That's you know, that's the Federation. That's the kind of ideal of the Federation, is bringing old enemies, bringing people together, bringing kind of understanding and compassion and a sort of mutual meeting of minds and of cultures as well. And that's one of the reasons that Darmok is such an effective episode as well. Another reason I love that episode is when we covered it on my podcast, Primitive Culture, it made me go off and read the Epic of Gilgamesh, which is something I would certainly never have done in any other context. But I would highly recommend to anyone who, you know, has any interest in the story as Picard presents it, because obviously he just gives a tiny glimpse of it. But I think the fact that he is able to do that, the fact that his way of connecting with this alien captain is to give something of his own culture back, and that kind of, that idea of an exchange, you know, as they keep saying, Temba, his arms wide, you know, giving something of yourself, giving that sort of generosity of spirit is, you know, really what Star Trek is for me, and certainly what Captain Picard is for me. And I think that episode is, for me, the quintessential Next Gen episode, because I don't think any other Starfleet captain that we've met would necessarily have succeeded in that mission the way that Picard did. It's so well matched for his kind of particular skill set and his particular kind of philosophy and approach, that he's the man who can kind of can bridge that gap ultimately. You know, the Temerian captain couldn't have picked a better counterpart to beam down with, in a way.
I agree with you. It's a very positive and uplifting episode. Let's turn to some episodes of a slightly more darker tone. Let's talk about Children of Time, Deep Space mm-hmm. Nine. So this is the one, for in case people don't remember, where Sisko et al. On the Defiant come across a planet and they discover their own descendants living there. And there's some plots hatched about whether or not they should try to go back in time and save these people, or if that's folly or not. and all of that. So tell me why you think this is an episode that's particularly meaningful.
Yeah, I think this is a wonderful episode. I've always really loved this episode. I was surprised to discover that some people aren't that wild about it. And I can see it's a slightly odd one in some ways. I think it does a really good job at kind of painting this community in quite a kind of real way. And I think the thing I like the most about it is it doesn't really take the easy narrative routes, I don't think. It makes the... I mean, I talked about how Star Trek is all about self-sacrifice, and obviously we do see characters sacrifice themselves in various ways throughout Star Trek and willing to, you know, give their lives to the greater good or whatever. I mean, whether it's Spock sacrificing himself in the Wrath of Khan, or Janeway, I feel, is kind of endlessly trying to, you know, go down with a ship, sacrifice herself, kind of, you know, she's the most sort of altruistic captain probably we see throughout Voyager. In this Deep Space Nine episode, what I like about it is that we see that making these kind of self-sacrifices is hard for people. And so, you know, we have the character of O'Brien, for example, who we know has a family back home on the station. You know, he's got a wife and kids, and he really doesn't want to give all of that up and not see those people again, even though he knows it's the right thing to do. And that's one of the moments that I really love in that episode, is O'Brien kind of grudgingly coming round to the fact that as much as it goes against what he actually wants, he's going to have to do the right thing because that's who he is. You know, he is a decent man. He's going to have to do it. And then the other element I really love in that episode is the fact that it's Odo who really undermines that whole sort of project. You know, they do make the very difficult decision to kind of do the right thing and to sort of sacrifice themselves in a sense so that these people can survive. And Odo, out of his unrequited love for Kira, which I think on TV we always see unrequited love as this very positive thing, it's a sort of noble thing, it's a sort of noble suffering in a way. But I think with Odo and Kira, it puts a really interesting spin on it in this episode, because Odo commits an appalling crime in a sense out of his love for Kira, you know, really to the extent that, to me, it turns his feelings for her in a very dark direction. You know, from then on, I can never quite forget that he was willing to do something so awful because he loved her so much. And it makes that kind of unrequited love seem dangerous and problematic. And I think Odo is a fascinating character in Deep Space Nine more generally. I mean, you know, because he's not someone you can always quite guarantee to do the right thing exactly. I mean, at various points, he does things for his own reasons. He does things that are kind of understandable to some extent. I mean, particularly when you get to the kind of Dominion occupation of the station, of course, he ends up in a very kind of compromising situation and makes some very surprising decisions in a way. But I think it's a great example of Deep Space Nine managing to, I suppose, juggle the various elements that make Star Trek work for me. So there's the kind of high concept element of that episode. You know, there's a kind of time effect going on. There's these people that they exist in, you know, can they exist or can't they? There's the kind of metaphysics of all of that. But there's also this real kind of strong emotional drama. Everything feels very grounded. It feels very connected. It feels very, that community feels quite real. They sell it emotionally, they make it believable. And I think that's one of the kind of real strengths of DS9 generally, is the ability to kind of marry the kind of bells and whistles of the sci-fi side of Star Trek with this real emotional heart. I mean, something like The Visitor, obviously, so many people say The Visitor's their favourite episode, kind of does the same thing again in a way. You know, yes, it's a sci-fi story. Yes, we see people in the future. We've got all that kind of sort of science fiction-y baggage around it. But ultimately, it's anchored by this, you know, just heartbreaking human emotion, in a sense, really bringing Star Trek back down to the kind of human level, which I suppose is something that started in Next Gen in a way, you know, particularly with Michael Piller. I think from the third season of Next Gen onward, we got much more of a sense of these characters as people rather than just these kind of sort of walking ideals of the future, in a sense. But Deep Space Nine really absolutely manages to sell believable characters. And I think, and often manages, I mean, people always talk about DS9 and their huge cast of recurring guest actors and so on, but even just characters within a single episode. I mean, I was just recently rewatching, for example, Past Tense, which I think is absolutely phenomenal, Deep Space Nine two-parter. The way that all the kind of minor characters in that story, whether it's the security guard or the receptionist or the administrator or whatever she is, all these characters feel totally real. They feel totally believable human beings. They're not just, you know, characters in the science fiction show.
I always love the guy with the hat.
Yeah, the guy with the hat maybe is a little bit closer to a sort of TV trope. But again, he, you know, there's an element of taking him seriously as a character. He's not kind of an out-and-out villain. They've given him a little bit more depth than that. And, you know, everyone in that story, I think there's a kind of real groundedness to them. And that's one of the things that I love about Deep Space Nine is how much effort is put into characterization and the kind of, you know, believability of these people as people with rich and complex and sort of, you know, vivid lives of their own.
As I watched Children of Time, I felt like this was an episode that had some of the highs and the lowest of the lows all wrapped into the same bundle.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what could it be like to meet your own descendants and find out that they honor the things that you honor and that they are living true to the ways that you taught them? You know, and I'm thinking particularly of Worf meeting the Klingons, right?
Yeah.
And meeting your descendants and seeing their lives. I mean, what could that even be like? And as a parent, I mean, it's mind blowing, right? It's, you know, you're seeing the fulfillment of all the hopes and dreams of when you have a child.
Mm.
So certainly very profound. Odo linking with himself. What is that even like? I mean, we all have that thought experiment of, you know, can you go back in time and tell yourself, you know, these three things about what to avoid or how to have a better life? But to actually link with yourself is something that I don't even think we have the words for it. But then Odo takes it upon himself to kill 8,000 men, women, and children for his crush. And the part that really gets me, I mean, besides the murdering of the 8,000 people, is that he has to tell her that he did it. Which I still can't get my mind wrapped around. I mean, how would anyone ever respond to that? Oh, I killed 8,000 people for you and I wanted you to know that.
I know, and put that kind of appalling responsibility on her almost. You know, it is almost something that like a serial killer would say to someone, or do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well, like the guy who tried to assassinate Ronald Reagan, didn't he, for Jodie Foster, whatever the reason was. There was some kind of, it was, you know, he thought he was doing it for her somehow. I mean, it's a kind of, yeah, unspeakable.
It's horrifying.
Thing to do. And I think, and obviously, you know, yes, it wasn't our Odo that did that. So in some ways she can't, no one can hold it against him because it wasn't him. It was, you know, it was future Odo. I mean, we don't hold Janeway responsible for what Admiral Janeway from the future does necessarily. But at the same time, I think it just really puts such a dark inflection on that ongoing storyline of, you know, Odo's love for Kira, because it twists it into such a kind of poisonous thing in a way.
Yeah, well, there's no way that she can't see that he's got darkness in him.
Yeah.
And I think it informs the way I think the founders are. It informs how we think of the founders, right? Is that, you know, we're supposed to like Odo, but then you think, what's with these founders, right? Why are they so hell-bent on trying to control everything, right? And
yeah,
there's some darkness in there, and we see some of that in Odo for sure. Speaking about darkness in people, tell me about Extreme Risk.
Well, yeah, that's an interesting one. I love that episode. I love, but of all the characters on Voyager, certainly B'Elanna Torres is my favourite and one of my favourite Star Trek characters altogether. And I think part of it is the way that Roxanne Dawson plays that character. I think she is a phenomenal actress and she always makes the most of everything they give her. Part of what I like about B'Elanna is, you know, she's not this kind of perfect, sort of perfected Starfleet character in a sense. She's got a lot of baggage. She's got a lot of personal issues. She's prone to, you know, in this episode, we see her prone to a real kind of crisis of mental health in a way. And I think it's played in a way that is very relatable and believable, you know, and to anyone who, you know, is either experienced or has known anyone who's experienced depression, it's quite relatable, I think, you know, seeing what she's going through and seeing what her friends, you know, what Chakotay's trying to do. Not that I entirely approve of the way that Chakotay deals with her crisis, but the desire to try and help someone in that situation, you know, the situation that Tom is in, not knowing how to get through to her. It feels very real. And I appreciate the fact that they chose to do that with that episode. I think up till at that point, or certainly sort of historically in Star Trek, you would have characters who sort of lost their mind for an episode in a sense, but there would always be an explanation. It would be some weird nebula was affecting their mental health, or there would be an alien that was impinging on them, or you know, whenever there was a story that seemed to kind of touch on mental health issues, there was a sort of science fiction-y reason for it. In this instance, it's a purely psychological reason. You know, she's learnt some terrible traumatic news and, you know, is understandably having a lot of trouble processing it and dealing with it. And this is where it takes her. And it takes her, you know, really pretty much to the edge. And I think B'Elanna is a character who is able to kind of explore that side of human nature and of the human experience in a way that a lot of Star Trek characters haven't been able to deal with it in some ways previously. I also really love the episode Lineage, where she finds out that the baby that she and Tom are having is going to have these quite prominent Klingon ridges, and she's very and she behaves very strangely in a way in that episode as a result of a lot of kind of psychological issues that she has personally. And I just feel like in some ways there's a sort of slightly soapy element of the backstory of that character, but the way that they deal with it, the way they tell those stories, is so well done and so well acted and well written and so on. I just they really work for me. And I think it's funny, I mean, I was thinking when you were asking, you know, who are your favorite characters in Star Trek, I said Picard is the kind of quite cool, quite aloof, very kind of composed, obviously aside from First Contact maybe, where we kind of see another side of his personality, but typically very kind of measured, very composed character. But at the other end of the extreme, I really love B'Elanna Torres. I really love Kira as well, another kind of quite, you know, certainly to begin with quite angry character, but justifiably angry. You know, she has every right to behave the way that she does and to feel the way that she does and to kind of be that frustrated and you know, has gone through a lot in her life. And I think it's great that Star Trek's been able to kind of incorporate both those sort of ends of the kind of spectrum of human personalities in some ways.
This episode struck me as having some bizarre contrast, because we have B'Elanna Torres undergoing this psychological issue, which to me was very reminiscent of like the cutting phenomena.
Yeah,
Very prevalent among adolescent girls for sure. Mm. And then you have the issue with the Malon freighters, and it seemed to me like they were doing fart jokes at one point. And it just seemed to me to be a very bizarre contrast between something that was very deep and profound and concerning and something that was almost comical in a way. Mm. With these other characters and the freighters with the gas coming out, and it seemed to be really weird to me. But I thought the episode was just really fantastic. But what really caught my attention in this episode was that at the end of the episode, the Malon people are struggling to rescue their other ship, and Voyager leaves them. And I was reminded of one of the original series episodes, Corbomite Maneuver, which people hold up as one of the best episodes of Star Trek. And when you ask why, they say, well, you know, because this guy was against us and then he needed help and we turned around and we helped him.
Yeah.
Right. And here we get the exact opposite behavior in another episode. So I just thought it was an interesting comparison that came to mind as I watched it.
Yeah, that is an interesting point. I mean, I suppose it's a kind of, there is that kind of slightly flippant rejection of the enemy that you get in a lot of, I mean, it's kind of a narrative trope in a way. You see it again in an interesting way, I think, in The Search for Spock, where Kirk tries to, he sort of offers to help Klingon, who's you know, been responsible for the death of his son, because he kind of feels like he has to offer to help him, and then he rejects it, and he's sort of pleased that he doesn't want the help, I think. Do you know what I mean? But that, yeah. So he's able to kind of experience the kind of catharsis of that moment of revenge or whatever. It's kind of excusable because he did offer, he did try, and it was rejected, and then it's like, right, well, screw you. I think you're right about the Corbomite Maneuver. I mean, that's another episode that I really love. I think that's a brilliant, unbearably tense episode, you know, great, great high stakes drama. And then at the end, absolutely, that's the Star Trek message. That is the, you know, really, if there's one thing that Star Trek is about, it's that kind of reaching out. It's that kind of compassion. It's that empathy for your enemy. I mean, some of the other episodes that I was thinking about when you were asking me to think of some favorite episodes, one of the ones I came up with for Voyager, which is not, I think, likely to be on many people's top five Voyager episodes or whatever, is the first season episode, Eye of the Needle. I absolutely adore that episode. I think arguably it came a bit early. I mean, a lot of people I've heard have said they should have at least made that the season one finale, but that's the episode where they find a wormhole and they find this Romulan on the other side of the wormhole who initially is very distrustful of them. You know, he thinks they're spies. He doesn't really believe them.
Yes, portrayed by the amazing Vaughn Armstrong, I might add.
Absolutely, yeah. And I think of all his roles, it's probably my favourite one, just because I love the episode so much. But it's the fact that, you know, Janeway is absolutely able to connect with this alien captain from a okay, not quite an enemy race, but at the time that he is at, because he's actually in the past, you know, the Romulans are very much mysterious. They've kind of cut themselves off. There is no communication with the Federation, I don't think, at all. They're kind of, you know, real kind of Cold War barrier between them, in a sense. But she absolutely manages to bridge that gap by appealing to his kind of humanity, in a sense, by appealing to him as a person. You know, she finds out that he has been in space for a year, that he's had a daughter that he's never met. And she basically is able to connect with him on just a purely human level of, you know, you are experiencing this kind of sorrow in your own life. You can imagine the sorrow that we're experiencing being far away from home, and manages to connect with him. And that, as I say, to me, is exactly what kind of Star Trek is about, in a way. I mean, another episode I was thinking of, The Devil in the Dark. Absolutely, you know, connecting with a very alien creature seems to be your enemy. In fact, you can understand each other. You have more in common than you think. And that, you know, again and again and again, that to me is sort of almost the sort of overarching theme of Star Trek, I suppose, is being able to reach out and kind of make that bridge.
Well, then let's talk about an episode where reaching out had more dubious results. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about The Ship from Deep Space Nine. This is the one where Sisko and Crowd crash on a planet and there are some Jem'Hadar and a Vorta. So, and of course, this is the first little trivia point. First time that you ever hear Spanish language spoken in Star Trek was in this episode. Little trivia there for you.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, it's a little something.
I didn't know
so
that.
Tell me why this episode is on the list.
I really love this episode. I think, again, it's one that doesn't maybe get as much love as it deserves. I suppose in some ways because it's quite a self-contained episode, although, of course, that ship does come back later on and plays a role in Deep Space Nine in the sixth season. But for me, it's really important in terms of kind of setting the tone, I think, of where the show was going from then onwards, because there's something about the kind of bleakness of that episode that really comes to inform the whole Dominion War going onwards, I think. It's the fact, in some ways, it's a kind of classic Star Trek ending, you know, oh, we were fools, if only we hadn't done this thing differently. But normally you expect that to be attached to another culture, to a kind of alien culture. And I think what Deep Space Nine does repeatedly is it kind of brings back, it puts the focus on us. So it's us that made the mistake. It's us that should have been more trusting. It's us that should have been able to give our enemy the benefit of the doubt, but we weren't. You know, neither side would back down, neither side would trust each other, and in the end the consequences were awful. You know, the founder dies, the O'Brien's assistant dies. It's one of those kind of situations which you get from time to time in Deep Space Nine, where there's a mission that kind of sort of goes horribly wrong and something good does come out of it in this instance, in that they get the ship, they get this kind of military asset in a sense, but on a human level nothing good comes out of it. And I really like also the way that it pushes the characters. You know, for example, there's that scene where everyone's getting very tense, everyone's getting very worked up, and Jadzia tries to sort of lighten. Well, I don't know if she is really trying to lighten the situation. She makes a kind of flippant, sarcastic remark, which is something that she often does as a character. She's got quite a good sense of humour. She often, you know, does try to use humour in situations, but she basically gets completely shut down because Sisko says, you know, I don't know if you noticed, but no one's laughing right now. This is really serious, terrible situation, and this kind of flippancy is not going to help. Everyone is really strained. They're under that kind of stress, and no one is sort of at their best. And I think it's a kind of crucible almost to put those characters in that situation and see how they cope under that kind of intense pressure. And for me, it really just, as I say, it sort of sets the tone for DS9 going forward in a way. In the same way as actually, you know, past tense that I mentioned earlier, I think acts as a kind of setup for the rest of DS9 going forward. You know, this very bleak situation, this real question hanging over it of, you know, is humanity essentially good and able to kind of transcend this, or do we have this kind of darker potential? I mean, Bashir gives that speech in past tense about if push comes to shove, you know, where will we end up, basically? And this is still in the kind of pretty much the sort of utopian era of Star Trek in a way. I mean, Next Gen, I guess, had just gone off the air by that point. It was sort of before Deep Space Nine had taken on the whole this kind of darker war-related turn. But at the same time, I think that speech from Bashir in the middle of the third season in past tense really kind of sets up a lot of these issues that come back of, you know, is this kind of utopia only really possible because we've got everything we need, we're not being put under too much pressure, we're kind of, life is relatively easy for Starfleet and for the Federation, and is there a danger that, you know, when our backs are up against the wall, we start to kind of, our standards start to slip in a way, our own kind of morals start to decline, we start to lose that kind
of... Well, in Deep Space Nine, the answer is yes.
Exactly.
I mean, the... Yeah, it is. There's no question, right? I mean, they pull back from the precipice in, what was it, Homefront? Is that the one I'm thinking of? Yeah,
with where there's the plot and everything.
To overthrow the president. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But in the Pale Moonlight, they go full speed ahead.
Yeah. And I mean, you know, you can debate the rights and wrongs of what Sisko does in that episode. I mean, I think there are obviously good pragmatic reasons for the actions that are taken in the Pale Moonlight. But it's definitely this idea of sort of moral compromise and of being willing to set your principles aside because there's something else, because the danger is that great, because the situation is that grim. You know, in Bashir's terms, push has come to shove by that point, and ultimately people are going to have to do things that they never thought they would have to do. And we see that again in Enterprise, of course, with the Zindi arc, you know, Archer having to do things that he never wanted to do. And the kind of, one of the things I like about the way that story plays out, although I know a lot of people disagreed with it at the time in terms of, because they felt it was sort of justifying things that were going on in the wider world in terms of the war on terror and so on, that it was kind of aligning itself in a way with those kind of decisions. But, you know, I liked the impact that we saw that it had on Archer later on, where he had that line in the episode Home. I think he said something like he wanted to go back to being the explorer that he said that his father always wanted him to be, that there was this kind of idea from, I suppose, from the past of this sort of innocence of what his mission involved, and that really when it came to it, it turned out that he had to become quite a different person in some ways, and that took something from him.
Let's turn to one more episode, and let's make it a Discovery episode. Let's talk about Leethi. Mm-hmm. So this is the one where we explore a little bit of Burnham's history with Sarek and what actually happened with Spock and sort of the root of Sarek's disagreement with Spock over his future career plans. So tell me why the M5 said we should talk about this episode.
Yeah, I really love this episode. I, like many people, when I first heard that Discovery was going to be about a character who was a sort of stepsister or adopted sister or whatever of Spock, I was extremely skeptical. And I do think to some extent that Discovery maybe leans a little bit too heavily on the kind of original series connections in some way, or at least that's a potential, certainly going into season two. And also I had mixed feelings about it being a prequel. I kind of felt like, why can't we, you know, have a sort of post-Nemesis series? Why can't Star Trek ever seem to move forward? You know, why do we keep going back and doing this sort of retro thing? On the other hand, all of that aside, Leethi was the episode that absolutely sold Discovery to me as a prequel series, because I think the way that they went into that kind of storyline of Spock and Sarek and so on, and really, you know, added detail in a way that doesn't feel like it's just kind of fan service. It doesn't feel like it's just like, you know, Archer saying, oh, there's going to be a directive of some kind. It's not that kind of cheap fan service. It's actually, it feels very real. It feels very psychologically grounded. It was a brilliant way of inserting something into a pre-existing story. The far opposite of that would be, say, these are the Voyages, where you try and insert something into a pre-existing story in a way that makes no sense psychologically and is bloated and kind of patently ridiculous. I think with Leethi, they absolutely nailed it. And it was the first episode of Discovery that actually made me gasp twice when I was watching it. First, when the Vulcan says to Sarek, you may choose one of your, whatever it is, whatever the term he uses, experiments. It was one of the strongest reactions I've had watching a piece of Star Trek, because I suppose no Star Trek's been new for quite a long time, because it just suddenly, it all fell into place. And, you know, the whole relationship between Sarek and Spock and all of this kind of built-up drama, suddenly you've got an insight into it and you understand something that's been going on in that relationship, and it all begins to kind of come together in a way. I just thought that was a brilliant piece of writing. Then later on in the same episode, we have the moment where Lorca, who we don't know, of course, at this point is actually Mira Lorca, has been having this very difficult business going on with Cornwall, and she's decided to try and get him to step down and so on. And then there's just that quite casual way that he says, oh, you know, yeah, we could send Admiral Cornwall instead of Sarek. And that, again, it kind of made me gasp, because I was like, oh my God, you know, what is he suggesting? What is he up to? I thought he was going to have a shuttlecraft blow up or something. So I just thought it was a very effective episode, because it really sold the kind of prequel element. It sold the kind of familiar, like it sold the fact that they'd inserted Burnham into this family, into Spock's family, in a sense. It kind of made, it justified all of that for me. It also, I think, to me, it meant something to me personally, maybe, because in my own life, I sort of feel like there are things in my childhood that I never really understood fully at the time, you know, things that weren't really explained to me as a child, that I've kind of grown up with sort of gaps or with uncertainties about, and sort of tried to go back and piece together those things. So I suppose for me personally, I could kind of identify with Burnham, you know, going into Sarek's memories and trying to make sense of this thing where, you know, her parent has really totally failed her. I mean, and I think it's also the kind of final nail in the coffin of Sarek's kind of relationship, reputation. It's kind of the final nail in the coffin of Sarek's reputation as a father, is the way he behaves in this episode. I mean, we've seen how badly he behaves with Spock previously. The way he behaves with Burnham in this episode is you know, it's awful. It's appalling. And you know, the way that she deals with it, and she says, you know, you can do better. And she's, you know, she's become the parent, really, telling her adopted father that he's, you know, he's failed her, basically, and that she's going to have to live with that. And I think that's a very powerful storyline, I suppose. So I think it's a great episode. Definitely my favorite of season one.
I'd agree with you. It is my favorite of season one as well, mostly because I'm very much interested in episodes about real human stuff. Yeah. You know, I enjoy the ships and I enjoy the, you know, time travel and spatial anomalies and, you know, pew, pew, pew and all that kind of stuff. But when you really think about Star Trek, right, it has to be about the people. Mm. And I think that this show in particular did the best in balancing a little bit of sort of robots and explosions and standard sci-fi tropes, you know, a little bit of action, I guess, with a story that was really about people trying to make their way in life and dealing with issues from their past that are profound, personal, and actually matter mm-hmm. to them. And they did it in quite an interesting and novel way. I really enjoyed it. And I hope to see more of that going mm-hmm. forward. I think that maybe we'll get some more of that in season two based on what we've been mm-hmm. told, but I'm curious to see what it's going to be like.
They also do it. I mean, I should say as well. Yeah, it does. It absolutely goes for a kind of emotional, the sort of personal familial drama. But at the same time, it is a Joe Manosky episode again, and it does it in a kind of wacky sci-fi way of the idea that you can kind of invade someone's memory and live inside their memory. And do you know what I mean? I mean, there is a kind of, again, a bit like Darmok in a way. There's a sort of high concept packaging to it. Do you know what I mean? It's wrapped up in quite a satisfying science fiction package. And we even get the kind of, it's almost like the Matrix somehow with all the, you know, martial arts and the kind of weird effects and everything inside that memory. But at the same time, at the heart, there's a totally relatable human story about someone, you know, as she says, you know, realizing that not only is she a disappointment to her father, but that he's a disappointment to her and that she's going to have to kind of deal with that.
Duncan, I have enjoyed talking with you.
Oh, good.
But I have to tell you that the M5 is signaling me furiously right mm-hmm. now that it is time for the Kobayashi Maru simulation.
Okay.
The Kobayashi Maru is a challenging and difficult test cunningly prepared by the M5. Should you not only survive the test, but pass it as well, the M5 will award you an honorary Star Trek title. Are you ready, Duncan?
I'm ready.
M5, load the Kobayashi Maru simulator and prepare to record Duncan's responses.
M5 working. Simulation loaded and ready.
If you were a founder, which Vorta should you eliminate? Keevan or Yelgren?
Keevan, because Yelgren is much more fun.
Baseball with Sisko or water polo with Archer?
Baseball with Sisko. I'd be pretty hopeless at both, but I'd go with the baseball.
Time for a snack. There are two items on offer. Some nice, juicy Yelg melon or Idanian spice pudding.
Spice pudding sounds fun to me.
Worst camping idea ever. Summer on Vulcan or winter on the moons of Andoria?
Yeah, summer on Vulcan. That would be pretty deadly, I think.
It's game night on Deep Space Nine. You have two choices. Tongo with Quark or Kotra with Garak?
Tonga with Quark sounds like the safer option to me.
Nice. Simulation complete, M5. Please compute the results and tell us if our guest has passed the Kobayashi Maru. Duncan, I am pleased to tell you that the M5 has calculated that you have passed the Kobayashi Maru simulation. Congratulations.
Thank you. What a relief.
What a relief. I have to admit, I am surprised that you picked to play with Quark.
Well, I don't know. I mean, Quark's a guy who knows how to have a good time, doesn't he? Whereas Garak, you're never quite sure if you can trust him. I was thinking about the water polo. I did actually play water polo at school, which probably puts me in a rare subset of Star Trek fans who've ever played water polo, but I wasn't particularly good at it. I've never played baseball in my life, but it looks like fun.
So you see the things you learn from the Trek Profiles podcast right here. Here's some trivia for you all out there, right? Name a Star Trek fan who has actually played water polo. There you go.
Yeah.
All right. And now, the M5, who has analyzed your answers, will award you an honorary Star Trek title on behalf of our podcast. M5, what title shall we award our guest?
Duncan is awarded the title of Chief Writer and Lore Master of the Atavikran on Planet Sarpedion.
Oh, wow, I'm honored. Thank you.
Duncan, please tell people how they can get in touch with you.
You can find me on Twitter at Barrett's Books, or you can listen to my podcast, Primitive Culture, over at Trek FM.
Thank you so much for being part of the Trek Profiles podcast.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Here ends this installment of the Trek Profiles podcast. And before we offer a Trek quote to close this episode, I'd like to remind you that you may send us your insightful commentary, love songs for the M5, or recipes for a nice Pippius Claw to feedback@trekprofiles.com, or on Facebook or Twitter at Trek Profiles. Anything you send us may be used in the show or flung hilariously into the Delta Quadrant, never to return. This week, I leave you with a quote from Tuvok, who in the episode Lineage said, quote, "Offspring can be disturbingly illogical, yet profoundly fulfilling. You should anticipate paradox." Close quote. Thanks for listening, and live long and prosper.